Hi, I'm Tommy Thompson and welcome to AI 101, the series that explores artificial intelligence tools and techniques used in video game development. One of the most demanding aspects of creating large, complex games that have expansive environments and various types of friendly and enemy characters is that we need something to help manage that experience for players. Quite often, games employ numerous background systems to help maintain the ambiance, be it to change the background audio, trigger in-world events, spawn enemies to fight against, or give the player a break after completing an immense task. And one of these systems is what is commonly known as a director, a term popularised by Turtle Rock and Valve's Left 4 Dead series, in which an AI system maintains the difficulty and pace of the game, deciding when and where to create new enemies, and decides not only if players deserve a break, but will deliberately target them if they don't abide by the rules of the game. So in this episode, let's explore what directors are, how they are used in a variety of modern games, and take a closer look at the system used in the Left 4 Dead series. So let's start by discussing what a director system is. The name is derived from the likes of film, television, and theatre, where a performance is being put on display for the audience. Cravats, mood swings, bitching about Netflix, and obnoxious coffee orders aside, a director's job is to ensure that the performance runs as intended, giving direction to all actors of what their job is, and then leave them to achieve it when the camera is running or the curtain has lifted. But unlike a theatrical production or a film set, in video games there is not only a lot less cocaine, but also the audience is an active participant in the production and impacting the story as it happens. Hence the director's system in a game needs to be a lot more dynamic, responding to what the player is doing and then reshaping the game world around them so that it continues to feel fresh and novel. This is all largely an antithesis to more tightly scripted and procedural gameplay, where you cross an invisible line in the game, often a trigger volume, that then results in something happening, often scientifically referred to as every Call of Duty game ever made. This can be a cutscene or something in-game that is entirely pre-programmed such that you always experience it the same way each time. By injecting a director, it helps provide a sense of novelty and in turn longevity for a game when it's in the hands of players, even if they begin to figure out what it's going to do and when. So a director is for all intents and purposes any system in a game that makes decisions on in-game settings or behaviours that impact pacing and difficulty, and is influenced by what players are doing in either a single or multiplayer context. Now this isn't necessarily an AI system, although you tend to find there is some simple AI formulation in many cases given it's making some sort of intelligent decisions. Ultimately though, it boils down to a fairly straightforward process. The system records information about the player's current activity. This could include where they are in the world, what activities they are currently doing, and how well they're doing it. The system then considers what the player should be experiencing at this point in time, such as a temporary increase in difficulty, a dynamic event in the world that perhaps has not occurred for a while, as well as what elements it can change or create right now to inject some new activity for the player to experience. Conversely, it could actually do the opposite and give the player some respite, allowing for you to catch your breath, take a moment to reassess the situation and what you want to achieve. Lastly, it's checking whether the player is playing the game as is intended. Quite often a director is useful for creating situations that ensure the player adheres to what the designers intended. As we'll see in a moment, Left 4 Dead is a fantastic example of this, given the director will deliberately target players who fail to adhere to the rules that the game communicates to you. So given we've covered the basics, how are they built and what purpose do they serve across different titles? What's important to acknowledge is that a director is more of a philosophy of game design than any sort of methodology or technology for that matter. Geez, try to say all that three times fast. But unlike, say, navigation meshes, finite state machines, behaviour trees, or GOP planning, all of which we've already covered on AI 101, there is no definition on how a director should work. Instead, it's simply a term given to systems that reflect the design principles I've already discussed. So, we'll start by explaining how Left 4 Dead's director works, but after that, we'll also briefly look at games that have since applied a similar principle, and why it proves useful to them. Left 4 Dead is an interesting game, in that everything you need to know about how it works is communicated in the opening video. Players need to stick together, try to navigate the space without causing a ruckus, and support one another when things go wrong, especially infected like hunters and boomers attack, or hordes of zombies appear in force. Now, the director's job is ensuring that players respect and follow those rules, by placing special infected in the world, setting spawn locations for mobs, gradually increasing and reducing the intensity of the game based on its internal clock, and, more critically, reinforcing the tension and drama of four people trapped in the zombie apocalypse by explicitly targeting players that don't obey the rules. So wind back for a second, and if we look at the director's behaviour more abstractly, it's essentially a finite state machine, which we covered back in episode 3 of AI 101 when looking at the AI of Half-Life. Now, this finite state machine operates in three states. The build-up, where the game is trying to challenge players' ability. In this state, the director is constantly maintaining a reference to the maximum number of zombies it can have, respawning enemies after they're mowed down, as well as introducing mobs that appear from outside of the player's line of sight, and of course, the special infected, such as hunters, smokers, and boomers. The whole time, the game is measuring how intense the game is becoming for each player, and prioritising not just those with the lower stress values, but also players that are farther away from the pack, given they're not in line with the director's expectations for how someone plays the game. Next up, there's the peak. This is where the system recognises it has reached a level of perceived stress across all players, having thrown everything in the kitchen sink at you, and it will cease spawning more zombies into the world. The music changes accordingly, and the game is giving you a real run for your money. And lastly, there is the relax phase. This is your period of respite. The game will either ensure no zombies spawn, or in the case of Left 4 Dead 2, less zombies than usual. This will only last for a short period of around 30 to 45 seconds, at which point it will restart the process back at the build-up. However, the rate of the build-up can be influenced by how the player progresses through the map, notably the speed at which you're moving through it. Hence, if you reach a relaxed phase and immediately start sprinting, the game will restart and build up much faster than usual, and the rate with which enemies are spawned will increase as well. Ultimately, the Left 4 Dead director is responsible for managing how many zombies are in the game at once so it stays performant, but it does so in a way that builds this roller coaster of player experience. However, with each pass through the state machine, the intensity and length of the cycle will vary, and as stated, it relies on the perceived stress of the player, which is calculated based on the rate at which enemies are being killed at close range. So if zombies are being picked off from afar, then the stress levels are quite low. However, if you're taking damage, using close range fire, or even melee attacks to kill them, then your stress value will be increasing at a much faster rate. All of this is actually visible for those who play Left 4 Dead on PC, with developer debug modes being a feature you can turn on when playing in single player. You can see the stages of the director, the spawn rates of the zombies, the stress levels of each character, and more. You can even manipulate parts of the director's behaviour and trigger specific actions that it would usually do. I'll leave some instructions on how to configure this if you want to try it yourself down in the video description. Now, this is but a quick overview of how Left 4 Dead's director works, but way back in episode 7 of AI in Games, I dedicated an entire episode to it. So go and check out that video to find out even more details. So having looked at Left 4 Dead, let's now explore some other games that have used similar director-style approaches and how they're adopted to enhance the player experience. While Left 4 Dead is a fixed and relatively linear game, the one area that directors are arguably used the most is in large open-world games. One of the reasons for this is the scale of the environment. Open-world games require the game engine to constantly load in assets for regions of the map as players visit them, whilst also unloading assets that are no longer being used. This is really important for non-player characters, given it's a waste of CPU and memory to have a character that's 5 miles away standing around and not doing anything important. Hence, most open world games have a director of some sort to ensure AI characters are spawning in the world, but also to despawn them if they're too far away from the action. One of the most well-known examples is from the Far Cry franchise, where the director has become increasingly more complex over time. Its primary function is ensuring characters are added and removed from the world, given that no characters in the world really exist outside of a roughly 250 meter radius of the player. Plus, it introduces vehicle patrols, wildlife such as tigers and bears, as well as more focused elements such as enemy checkpoints or unlocked outposts coming under attack. Meanwhile, games such as Watch Dogs 2 have a system that spawns in non-player characters based on personality profiles, whilst also paying close attention to where the player is in the world. Hence, you find college students near the Stanford campus tech bros over in Silicon Valley, and arrogant douchemongers and tourists when you're down on the Embarcadero. Meanwhile, a different system is employed in CD Projekt Red's The Witcher 3.
Oh my god, yep, that's right, Tommy just mentioned The Witcher and AI in games, ooh!
The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt has a similar process known as spawn trees. This isn't actually a simple director system, given it's a larger gameplay system that's integrated not just into the open world, but is synced into all of the systemic gameplay and mission systems. This helps the game to spawn in non-player characters, be they friend or foe, that fit the context of where Geralt is in the world, and is highly customizable so that it can adapt and shift to specific designer needs. There are numerous permutations of director AI in open world games, with varying depth and complexity in each instance. What is interesting, however, is that these systems are now beginning to evolve, with the more recent entries in the Assassin's Creed franchise, Origins and Odyssey, introducing a process known as virtualization, where some NPCs, even if they're not visible in the world, will continue to update their logic and make decisions about what they're doing and where they're going instead of being outright deleted. More critically, they also remember their interactions with the player, such that if you meet them again later, they will remember how things went down previously, and that influences their future behaviour. However, outside of some of these larger open-world games, there are other titles that use some form of director AI. One notable example is Overkill's Payday 2 from 2013. In Payday 2, the director revolves around the risk level, the difficulty setting applied to a particular mission. There are 9 different risk levels, ranging from easy all the way up to death sentence. The risk level influences your mission requirements, as well as the types of safes and security deployed within the level. But while it can change the mission you're about to run, it has a much larger impact on how law enforcement attempt to bring you down. Your risk level will influence not just how effective law enforcement is in combat, but the number of assault waves, the frequency with which they spawn in, what enemy types spawn, and where they spawn in the map. Oh yeah, that's right, here's one you probably didn't expect. Rocksmith, the music game developed by Ubisoft San Francisco and first released in 2011. Rocksmith helps players learn the guitar and bass tracks for a variety of songs. However, in the updated edition released in 2014, Rocksmith introduced session mode, where instead of playing along to an existing song, you can jam and play your own tunes. However, the director pays attention to what you're playing and uses that to inform the AI musicians in the session, be it the drummer or the bass player, what pace to play at, the intensity of their play, as well as what notes and scales to play that would better complement the music you're playing. And wrapping up, arguably the most famous example on this channel, surpassing even that of Left 4 Dead, is Alien Isolation.
Ring the bell, lads, he's talking about Alien Isolation again.
As has already been explained in great detail on this channel, while the Xenomorph has a behaviour tree that enables it to respond to sensory inputs, hunt the player and attack them when spotted, there is also a director that is tasked with giving the alien locations to visit. Hence, it will not only encourage the alien to continue to move around the map so that the player can proceed with their mission, but it will also redirect the alien back to the player periodically in the event they've escaped it for too long. All of this ensures that the alien doesn't overwhelm the player, keeping them trapped in a locker for 8 hours. Though I understand why you may well still do that. Director AI is not a precise technological process, but rather a philosophy for how a gameplay system can make intelligent decisions that influence a player's experience. As we've seen throughout this video, the range of titles they're used in is fairly broad, and the purposes for which they're adopted can vary even between similar games. But critically, it's all about keeping the player at the heart of the experience and ensuring that they're playing the game in the way that the designers intended, and, you know, hopefully having some fun as well while they're at it. Thanks for watching this episode of AI 101. I hope you enjoyed finding out a bit more about Director AI. Don't forget, you can go back and watch the actual episode of AI in Games dedicated to Left 4 Dead, but also Far Cry 4's director was covered in episode 16, and, of course, Alien Isolation has popped up twice in episodes 15 and 50. Plus, there were some games we've never seen before on AI in Games in this video. Let me know if some of these sound interesting, given we could try and visit them in more detail in the future. AI 101 and all my other series here on AI in Games are crowdfunded over on Patreon, and this episode was selected by my supporters as one they wanted to see, with a special shout out to patron Joey Keelhalls. If you want to join our community and have a say in future episodes on the show, join the AI in Games Patreon using the links on screen and in the description.